طيب، بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، today we begin the second lesson from القواعد الأربع. So the four principles from Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab with the explanation of Sheikh Saleh Al Fawzan حفظه الله. The Sheikh, so we left off at this point, still in the introduction before the four principles. So the Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab, he mentions, اعلم أرشدك الله لطاعته أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم أن تعبد الله مخلصا له الدين كما قال تعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. So the Sheikh, he begins with the introduction. He said, no, Allah guide you to his obedience, that Hanifiyya is the religion of Ibrahim, and that is to worship Allah sincerely, as is mentioned in the statement of the Most High in the Quran in Surah Al-Dhariyat, verse 56, and I did not create mankind or jinn except to worship me alone. So worship me. So here the Sheikh is going to explain this introduction statement by Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. So I'lam arshadak Allah. Here, this is a dua. هذا الدعاء من الشيخ رحمه الله وحكذا ينبغي للمؤلم أن يدعو للمتعلم. So the Sheikh Saleh Fawzan mentioned this, you know, no, Allah guide you. This is a dua from Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, may Allah have mercy upon him. And like this is suitable for the teacher to make a dua for his students, for the one who's learning. So وطاعة الله معناها امتثال أو أوامره واجتناب نواهيه. So the Sheikh, he mentions that obedience to Allah meaning is that you obey the commands and you stay away from the prohibitions. So his commands, obeying Allah's commands and staying away from his prohibitions, that's the obedience of Allah. So whatever Allah commands you, you do, and whatever Allah prohibits you from or makes haram, you stay away from. Then he said, أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. So in this statement, that حنيفية is the religion of Ibrahim. Allah جل وعلا أمر نبينا باتباع ملة إبراهيم. قال تعالى ثم أوحينا إليك أن اتبع ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين. So it mentions that Allah, the Most High, he commanded our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to follow the religion of Ibrahim. In his statement, ثم أوحينا, let me just get that think about this here. ثم أوحينا. He said, then we have sent revelation to you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, saying, follow the religion of Ibrahim, Hanif, Islamic monotheism, to worship none but Allah, and he was not of the mushrikeen, polytheists, idolaters, and disbelievers. So this is a command for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and us to follow the religion and the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Al-Hanifiyya, so the Sheikh is going to explain that, millatu Hanif wa huwa Ibrahim. So Hanifiyya is the religion of Hanif, which is who is Ibrahim alayhi salam, salatu salam. Wal hanif huwa al muqbil ala Allah al mu'rid amma siwahu. So then the Sheikh, he explains what hanafiyya and hanif is. So he says hanif, he is the one who he devotes himself to Allah and he turns away from other than Allah. So this is Hanif. And you know, the one who devotes himself and turns to Allah with his heart and his actions and his intentions and what he intends and his goals, all of that is for Allah. And he turns away from what is other than Allah. And Allah, so he says, Al-Muqbil al-Allahi بقلبه وأعماله ونياته ومقاصده كلها لله المؤرد أما سواه والله أمرنا باتباع ملة إبراهيم. And Allah commands us with following religion of Ibrahim, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ مِلَّةِ أَبِيكُمْ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. And then I'm just going to check that ayah. So that's وَمَا, let's just get that, and that is, bear with me a second, I had that located, وَمَا. There, for it. So it says, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ. And that is in وَمَا جَعَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. Yeah, found it here. So here, mentions, Allah mentions word in the full ayah of the Surah Hajj, and it's verse, let's see, it's verse 78. And then he said, at the beginning of the whole ayah is, and strive hard in Allah's cause as you ought to strive with sincerity with all your efforts, that His name should be superior. He has chosen you to convey His message of Tawheed to mankind by inviting them to His religion. And this is the ayah that the Shaykh mentioned, and has not laid upon you in religion any hardship. And He's not placed laid upon you in religion any hardship. In any hardship, it is the religion of your father Ibrahim, Islam, monotheism. It is he Allah who has named you Muslims both before and in this Quran, that the message of Allah may be a witness over you and you be a witness over mankind. So perform a salah and give zakah and hold fast to Allah. I have confidence in Allah and depend upon Him all your affairs. He is your Mawla, your patron Lord, and what an excellent Mawla, patron Lord, and what an excellent helper. So that was for the proof of that. And then then the Shaykh said, "Hadihi Hanifiya." This Hanifiya, ma qala an ta'budullah. And we got there. And then he said, "Wa millata Ibrahim an ta'budullah mukhlisan lahu ad-din." And worship, and Hanifiya, and the religion of Ibrahim is that you worship Allah sincerely, and to Him belongs all the religion. So hadihi hanifiyya, the Shaykh mentions this hanifiyya, Allah didn't say ma qala an ta'budu Allah faqat. He didn't say only worship Allah only. Rather, Allah said mukhlisan lahu ad-din, that sincerely for Him is the religion. So yani wa tajtanib ash-shirk li'anna al-ibada idha khalataha ash-shirk batalat. فَلَا تَقُولْ إِبَادَةً إِلَّا إِذَا كَانَتْ سَالِمَةً مِنَ الشِّرْكِ الْأَكْبَرِ وَالْأَصْغَرِ. So it means that you stay away from shirk. Yeah. So because that's the opposite of sincerity of tawheed. Yeah? Because worship, if it's mixed with shirk, then it's nullified. Yeah. And then it won't be worship, except, and worship is not considered worship, except if it is free and safe from shirk, whether it be the shirk, major shirk or minor shirk. Then the Shaykh says, كَمَا قَالَ تَعَالَى وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ هُنَفَاءَ. So then the Shaykh mentions, like he mentions in the Quran, and they were commanded not but that they should worship Allah and worship none but Him alone, abstaining from ascribing partners to Him, and perform a salah and give zakah, and that is the right religion. Then the Shaykh says, Jam Hanif. So Hunafa here, he said, and they were not commanded, as you mentioned, and they were commanded not but that they should worship Allah and worship none but Him alone, abstain from any partners. And when they mention here, Hunafa wa yuqimu salah. So Hunafa here is the plural of Hanif. So being the religion of Islam, here gives another proof that what we are meant to do is follow on from the way of the Prophet Ibrahim al-Islam. So Hunafa is a plural of Hanif. Wa huwa And what is Hanif meaning? Al mukhlis lillah azza wa jal, meaning sincere to Allah, the Most High. Wa hadhihi al ibada, and this is worship. Amar Allahu biha jami'ul khalq kama qala ta'ala, and this is worship that Allah commanded all of the creation, as he said in the Most High, wa ma khalaqtul jinna wal insa illa liyabudun. Or he said in Surah Al-Dhariyat verse 56, and I did not create mankind or jinn except to worship me. Wa ma'na ya'budun, and the meaning of worship here in this ayah, and the worship is yufriduna bil ibada, to single out Allah in worship. Fal hikmatu min khalq al halq annahum ya'budun Allah azza wa jal mukhlisin lahu ad-din minhum man imtathala wa minhum man lam yamtathil. لكن الحكمة من خلقهم هي هذه فالذي يعبد غير الله مخالف للحكمة من خلق الخلق ومخالفة الأمر والشر. So then the Sheikh mentions that the meaning of worship is to single out Allah alone with that worship, and is from the wisdom of the creation of the creation, as we mentioned, and Allah mentions in the ayah, and I did not create mankind and jinn except to worship Allah alone. So that is the goal, that is the purpose of life, that we worship Allah, so that they worship Allah sincerely, for him is the religion, and from them, creation, from the people and the jinn, are those who obey Allah. And then there are those who did not obey Allah. But the wisdom in creating them, that is for them to worship Allah. So the one who worships other than Allah, he's opposing this wisdom, and he's opposing the one who created the creation. And he's opposing the command of the commands and the sharia and the legislation. So Ibrahim huwa abu al-anbiya alladhina ja'u min ba'dihi fa kulluhum min dhurriyyati wa li hadha qala jalla wa ala wa ja'alna fi dhurriyyatihi an-nabuwa wal kitab fa kulluhum min bani Israel hafid Ibrahim alayhi salam وَإِلَّا مُحَمَّدْ سَعَسَمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ إِسْمَعِيلِ فَقُلُّ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ عليه الصلاة والسلام تَكْرِيمًا لَهُ وَجَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِمَامًا لِلنَّاسِ يعني قدوة. قال إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا يعني قدوة. إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً يعني إِمَامًا يُقْتَدَى بِهِ وبذلك أمر الله جميع خلق كما قال تعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. فإبراهيم دعا الناس إلى عبادة الله عز وجل كغيره من النبيين. كل الأنبياء دعوا الناس إلى عبادة الله وترك عبادة ما سواه كما قال تعالى ولقد بعثنا في كل أمة رسولا أن اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت. So the Sheikh here mentions that an Ibrahim, when we mention Ibrahim and the religion of Ibrahim, we mean he is the father of the prophets. And that is a kunya that's given him, father of prophets, that came after him. So you see, other prophets, they might have not been connected in terms of relation before him, but the prophets that came after him, they are from his progeny. So all of them are from his progeny, and for this reason, Allah the Most High says, he said in the Quran, "Waja'alna," and we have created in the progeny of Ibrahim prophethood. Let me just get that. Waja'alna. Yeah. So he said, and we ordained among his offspring prophethood and the book, i.e. the Torah to Musa, the Injil to Isa, and the Quran to Muhammad. So So that is the ayah. So for all of the, so all of them from Bani Israel. So all the prophets and messengers were from Bani Ismail. They were what? The grandchildren of Ibrahim alayhi salam, except for Muhammad alayhi salam, because he was from the progeny of Ismail, his other son. So he wasn't from the progeny of Bani Israel. And why do we call him Bani Israel? After Yaqub alayhi salam, he was called Israel as well. And Yaqub alayhi salam was the son of Isaac, who was the son of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he was the brother of Ismail. Ismail was the older brother, and he was the one who settled with his mother Hajar in Mecca. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from his progeny. So all the prophets were from the, so all these prophets after Ibrahim alayhi salam were from the children of Ibrahim, like our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon them all. And that was in honor of him, in honor of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allah made him an imam, a leader for the people, meaning an example, a model. Qala, Allah mentions, Qala in, Allah said, indeed I'm going to make you for the people an imam. So he said, Allah said to him, verily I am going to make you an imam, a leader for mankind to follow you. So that was that. And then meaning an example. So then Allah also mentioned, inna Ibrahim kana ummatan. So indeed Ibrahim was a nation, meaning he was an imam, meaning he was an imam that needed to be followed, yeah, and obeyed. And with that, Allah commanded all of the creation, as the Most High said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَبْدُونَ. So he commanded Ibrahim to worship and called people to worship, and likewise he commanded all of mankind and jinn. And I did not create mankind or jinn except to worship me alone. In Surah Dhariyat, verse 56 again. So Ibrahim called the people to worship Allah alone, like others from the prophets and messengers. So all the prophets and messengers, they called the people and invited them to worship Allah and to leave worshipping other than Him. As the Almighty said, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولٌ أَنِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. And Allah mentions that, and verily we sent among every ummah, community, nation, a messenger proclaiming worship Allah alone and avoid or keep away from ta'ghut, all false deities, meaning do not worship ta'ghut besides Allah. So that's the meaning of the ayah. So the call to tawheed and, you know, warning against shirk. Then the Shaykh, he says, وَأَمَّا الشَّرَائِ الَّتِي هِيَ الْأَوَامِرُ وَالنَّوَاحِي والحلال والحرام فهذه تختلف باختلاف الأمم حسب الحاجات يشرع الله شرعية ثم ينسخه بشرعية أخرى إلى أن جاءت شرعية الإسلام فنسخت جميع الشرائع وبقيت هي إلى أن تقوم الساعة. أما أصل الدين الأنبياء هو التوحيد فهو لا ينسخ ولا ينسخ ولن ينسخ دينهم واحد وهو دين الإسلام بمعنى الإخلاص لله بالتوحيد. أما الشرائع فقد تختلف تنسخ لكن التوحيد والعقيدة من آدم إلى آخر الأنبياء كلهم يدعون إلى التوحيد وإلى عبادة الله وعبادة الله طاعته في كل وقت بما أمر به ومن الشرائع فإذا نسخت صار العمل بالناسخ هو الإبادة والعمل بالمنسوخ ليس عبادة الله عبادة لله. So then the Sheikh he says as for the Sharia, the legislations and the commands and the prohibitions and the halal and haram, then these differ. Yeah, with the differing of the nations according to their need. So Allah chose different legislations for different nations. So Allah legislated a Sharia, then He abrogated it with another Sharia, with another legislation. until there came the Sharia of Islam of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So then he abrogated all the other legislations before it, and it remained, and it will remain until the establishment of the hour, the day of judgment. So this Sharia will remain until the day of judgment. And as for the origin, the foundation of the religion of all the prophets, then it is Tawheed. So all of them called to Tawheed. All of them had one message, Tawheed, and forbidding from shirk. Yeah? So even if you were to ask, this is an easy way to refute the way of the Christians, is to ask them, is Jesus God? Is Jesus Allah? And they say, yeah. Then say, why did all the other messages you believe in, all of them, from Adam all the way to before Musa, they believe in Musa alayhi salam as well. So why didn't they all say Jesus is God? Why did they worship? They call to worship one God alone. They didn't worship. They didn't call to worship three gods in one. So that's a clear refutation, because all the prophets came with one message, was to worship Allah alone, and to stay away from falling into shirk, worshiping other than Allah. So this Tawheed, it will not be abrogated. And it wasn't abrogated, and we will never be abrogated. So all of the prophets had one religion, and that is Deen of Islam. So all of them had one religion of Islam, and that means to sincerity for Allah, being sincere to Allah with Tawheed. That is Islam. So as for the legislations, then they differ. They can be abrogated. But Tawheed and Aqeedah, your belief, Aqeed, your creed, from Adam alayhi salam. So all of the prophets, they came with one creed, one Aqeedah. Yeah, they don't have like some of the people of deviation, like they might say, oh, the Ashari creed or Maturidi creed or this creed. No, the creed is the same for all of the prophets, from Adam alayhi salam unto Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Sahaba followed that same belief. And we believe that same belief about Allah. And that Tawheed is the same as well. So Tawheed and Aqeedah, from Adam until the last of the prophets, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of them came and they called to Tawheed and to worship Allah alone. And they all believed in one Aqeedah. And worshipping Allah is his obedience in every time with what he commanded with from the legislation. So if a piece of legislation is abrogated, then the action has become something that is abrogated. So if the action becomes abrogated, so then the new law or the legislation, that is ibadah, and then you act with the new legislation. But as for us, continuing to act upon something that's abrogated, then that is not worship. So, for example, Allah abrogated some of the Sharia of the past nations. If a person says, no, I want to continue upon that Sharia, then that's not accepted from him, because the new Sharia is what? If the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that in a hadith, that if Musa was to come back, alayhi salam, he would have to follow the Sharia of Muhammad, my Sharia. He wouldn't be allowed to follow the Sharia that was sent to him. And likewise, we know in the return of Isa alayhi salam, he will not be following the Sharia that he was following before, which was of Musa alayhi salam, and what was sent additionally to him from in the Injil. No, he'll be following the Sharia of Muhammad alayhi salam. So that is a clear proof as well, when Isa alayhi salam returns near the end. Then the Sheikh, he said, قال الشيخ فإذا عرفت أن الله خلقك لإبادته فأعلم أن الإبادة لا تسمى إبادة إلا مع التوحيد. So the Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab mentions that if you know that Allah created you to worship Him, then know that worship is not called worship except with Tawheed. So this is very important. So what the Sheikh is going to explain now. So he mentioned that if you know that Allah created you, the purpose was to worship Him. So if you know this, that وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, so you know that the ayah, Allah did, and I did not create jinn or mankind except to worship me alone, then وَأَنْتَ مِنَ الْإِنسَ وَمِنَ الْإِنسَ, that you are from mankind, دَاخِلٌ فِي هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ, that you're intended in this ayah, that you're the one who's being addressed, jinn and mankind, that you're, this is your purpose. وَعَرَفْتَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَا خَلَقَكَ أَبَثًا, that, and you know that Allah didn't create you out of play. أو خلق لتأكل وتشرب فقط, and Allah did not create you to eat and drink only. تعيش في هذه الدنيا وتسرح وتمرح, and that you live in this world, and that you know is basically enjoyment, it's wandering and having a laugh. That's all it is, you know, wandering about and having luck. And Allah didn't create you for this. Yeah, Allah created to worship Him, so it wasn't for no purpose. Allah created for to worship Him. وَإِنَّمَا سَخَّرَ لَكَ هَذِهِ الْمَوْجُودَاتِ مِنْ أَجْلِ أَن تَسْتَعِينَ بِهَا عَلَى إِبَادَتِهِ لِأَنَّكَ لَا تَسْتَطِيعُ أَن تَعِيشَ إِلَّا بِهَذِهِ الْأَشْيَاءِ. So Allah subjugated everything that is present in order that you utilize them and use them to worship Allah, because you are not able to live except with these things. So for example, the night and the day, the sun and the moon, we know the times to worship Allah, other things that Allah has subjugated to us, as well as the animals and everything, so we can travel, perform the Hajj and Umrah, and many other things. So وَلَا تَتَوَسَّلْ إِلَى إِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بِهَذِهِ الْأَشْيَاءِ, and so you will not reach or attain the worship of Allah except by using these things that Allah has subjugated for you. So Allah سَخَّرَ اللَّهُ لَكْ لِأَجْلِ أَن تَعْبَدُهُ, Allah subjugated all the things in the world for you to so that you can worship Him. لَيْسَ مِنْ أَجْلِ أَن تَفْرَى بِهَا وَتَسْرَى وَتَمْرَى وَتَفْسُقْ وَتَفْجُرْ تَأْكُلْ وَتَشْرَبْ و ما اشتهيت هذا شأن البهائم أما الآدميون فالله جل وعلا خلقهم لغاية عظيمة وحكمة عظيمة وهي العبادة. قال تعالى وما خلقت الجنة والإنس ليعبدون ما أريد منهم من رزق ألا الله ما خلقك لتكسب له أن تحترف وتجمع له مالا كما يفعل بنو آدم بعضهم لبعض يجعلون أمالا يجمعون لهم المكاسب, لا الله غني عن هذا والله غني عن العالمين, ولهذا قال ما أريد منهم من رزق وما أريد أن يطعمون, الله جل وعلا يطعم ولا يطعم, غني عن الطعام وغني جل وعلا بذاته, وليس هو في حاجة إلا عبادة وليس هو في حاجة إلى عبادتك, لو كفرت نقصت ما نقصت ملك الله, ولكن أنت الذي بحاجة إلي, أنت الذي بحاجة إلى عبادة, فمن رحمته أنه أمرك بإبادته من أجل مصلحتك, لأنك إذا أبدته فإنه سبحانه وتعالى يكرمك بالجزاء والثواب, فالإبادة سبب لإكرام الله لك في الدنيا والآخرة. So I'm just going to finish that. So فمن الذي يستفيد من الإبادة, المستفيد من الإبادة هو عابد نفسه, أما الله جل وعلا فإنه غني عن خلقه. So this is important paragraphs here. There are the Sheikh mentions that Allah, when you get here, Allah mentions, so the Sheikh mentions that you are not able to live without these things to use these things to worship Allah, and Allah has subjugated these things that you can make it easy for you to worship Allah, and it's not for you to, you know, be pleased with, and you know, and that wander around with these things, and that you have fun and a laugh with these, and that you commit sin, and that you eat and drink and do what you desire. So this is the way of the animals. So this is not the way, the purpose that the humans were created. So as for the humans, mankind, then Allah, the Most High, created them for a lofty goal and for great wisdom, and that is to worship Him, to worship Allah the Most High said, and I did not create mankind or jinn except to worship me, except to worship me alone. And then it continues to the next ayah, and I seek not any provision. So Allah saying, I seek not any provision from them, provision for themselves or for my creatures, nor do I ask that they should feed me, or feed me or my creatures. So here, Allah doesn't need us, showing that Allah doesn't need us, we need Allah. So Allah, He says, Allah did not create us so that we can, you know, earn for Him. And you know, that we can gather wealth for Him, as you know, the children of Adam, some of them do for others. They make some people become their workers, who gather for them a lot of wealth. No, Allah is free from that. Allah is free from, you know, the whole of mankind, the jinn and all that exists. For this reason, Allah says, I do not. Ma aridu minhum, I seek not any provision from them. Yeah, nor do I ask that they should feed me. So Allah mentions that in this ayah. So Allah, the Most High, He is the one who feeds, and He does not need to be fed. Yeah, and He is the one. He's free from needing food, and He is free, the Most High, in His essence, from all this, and He is not in need of your worship. So Allah is not need that you worship Him. So if you were to disbelieve, it would not, you know, decrease in the kingdom of Allah anything. Rather, but it is you who is in need of Allah and the worship, and is you who is in need of worshiping Allah. So, and from His mercy to you, that He commanded you with His worship, so that for your benefit, because if you worship Him, then indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor you with reward, reward, and the worship is a reason or a cause for your Allah honoring you in the dunya and in the hereafter, and whoever worships Allah, he benefits from that. So basically, the Shaykh said, who is the one who benefits from worship? The one who benefits from the worship, that is the one who's worshipping himself. As for Allah, then He is free of need of all of the creation. So Allah is not in need of that. But we are the ones who are in need of worshiping Allah. So then the Shaykh, he says, فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ لِعِبَادَتِهِ فَأَلَمْ أَنَّ الْعِبَادَ لَا تُسَمَّ عِبَادَةً إِلَّا مَا التَّوْحِيدِ كَمَا أَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ لَا تُسَمَّ الصَّلَاةَ إِلَّا مَا التَّحَارَةِ. So then the Shaykh, he says that, know that Allah, if you know that Allah created you to worship Him, then you should also know that worship is not called worship except with Tawheed. Like Salah is not Salah except with purification. So the Shaykh, he explains that so he said that if you know that Allah created you for His worship, إذا عرفت أن الله خلق لعبادته فإن العبادة لا تكون صحيحة يرضاها الله سبحانه وتعالى إلا إذا توفر فيها شرطان إذا اختل شرطاً من الشرطين بطلت. So that the Sheikh he mentions, if you know if you know that Allah created you for His to worship Him, that He worship is not correct, and Allah is not pleased with it, the Most High, except if it contains or has in it two conditions. So if one of these conditions is is not there present, then is that worship is nullified. So the first one is ashart al-awwal, the first condition for the worship to be accepted is an taquna khalisan liwajhi Allah, that is sincerely for the face of Allah, laysa fiha shirk, and there's no shirk in it. So the first condition for the worship to be accepted is that it's got to be sincerely for Allah, and that it doesn't have no shirk in it. فَإِنْ خَالَتَهَا الشِّرْكَ بَطَلَتْ. So if shirk mixes with it, then it is nullified. مثل طحارة إذا خالتها حدث بطلت. So same way with wudu, with purification, if there's hadith in there, yeah. So if there's hadith and you break wind, then the tahara is nullified. Or if there's any impurification, then it's nullified. Like كذلك إذا أبدت الله ثم أشركت به بطلت عبادتك هذا الشرط الأول. So likewise, if you worship Allah, then you commit shirk with Him, then your worship it becomes nullified, and this is the first condition. So the first condition again is sincerely for Allah, so there's no shirk in that. When shirk enters, then it's nullified. Same way, like purification is nullified with impurities. الشرط الثاني, the second condition, المتابعة لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and that is following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فأي عبادة لم يأتي بها الرسول فإنها باطلة مرفوضة. So any act of worship the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم didn't come with, then that act of worship is rejected. لأنها بدعة وخرافة. So then it is because it is an innovation and something that is from superstition or something that people made up. ولهذا, and for this reason, the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, "من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو راد." Whoever acts with an action that is not according with our faith, meaning our religion, then it is rejected, meaning it's not accepted by Allah. And in another narration, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. Whoever innovates in this affair, meaning religion of ours, that which is not from it, will have it rejected. So فلا بد أن تكون الإبادة موافقة لما جاء به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So it's a must that worship be in agreement with what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came with. Otherwise, it's rejected. لا بإحتسانك لا باستحسانات الناس ونياتهم ومقاصدهم ما دام أنها لم يدل عليها دليل من الشرع فهي بدعة ولا تنفع صاحبها بل تضره لأنها معصية وإن رغم أنه تقرب بها إلى الله عز وجل. So then the Sheikh said, we don't worship with what people think that is good, yeah, and their intentions, yeah, and their goals, So even if we only intend good, it reminds you of the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, where one of the companions, he came after the Prophet ﷺ passed away, because another person, one of the Tabi'in or companion knocked on him, was a Tabi'in, advising that some people were doing something strange in the masjid. When he seen, they were all in a circle and they were counting and doing dhikr, and they had beads or pebbles, stones that they were counting and making dhikr. And one person said, "Allahu Akbar," all of them said, "Allahu Akbar." One of them said, "Subhanallah," all of them, "Subhanallah." He said, "What is this?" Rough meaning of the hadith, like the pots and pans and the clothing of the Prophet ﷺ are still here, and yet you're doing this. We only intended good. He said, "How many intend good but never achieve it?" So intention alone is not good. This is the mizan, this is the scale. Whoever does an action that is not according to the action of the religion, of what the Prophet ﷺ came with, then is rejected. Whoever innovates in the religion that is not from it, then is rejected. That is the scale for the acceptance of action, bid'ah. If it's a bid'ah, it's not accepted. So then the Shaykh said, as long as it's like that, it's an innovation or it's a something that the religion does, or the Sharia does not guide to, then it is a bid'ah, and it does not benefit the person who does it. Rather, it harms that person, and it's a sin. Even if that person, even if he, thinks that is something that will make him come close to Allah. So even if he claims that, it will not benefit him, rather it will harm him. And then that's why some of the Salaf would say that indeed bid'ah is more beloved to shaitan than sin. Why? Why would someone say that? Because from sin, if you know, it comes down to it, whether you make the dua, you say, oh Allah, forgive me for the sins I've committed, the ones that are apparent, the ones that are hidden, the small from them, the big from them, the ones that I know, the ones that I don't know, Allahumma ameen, and Allah bi'idhnillah will forgive you. But when have you seen a person who does bid'ah? Someone who sees it as good, will he turn around and ask Allah, oh Allah, forgive me for the Eid Milad al-Nabi that I did last weekend? No, because they think it's good. Oh, I did this salah that is not meant to happen, and I did this, because they think it's good. They will never make the tawbah for that. They will never seek forgiveness from Allah for that. So that is important for us. So the two conditions again were for the worship to be accepted, sincerity for the sake of Allah, so there's no shirk. And so the opposite is shirk. And the other one was following the Prophet ﷺ, the sunnah. And the opposite is what? Did they not follow the Prophet ﷺ, which is bid'ah. Yep. So then the Shaykh says, فَلَا بُدْ فِي الْإِبَادَ مِنْ هَذَيْنَ الشَّرْتَيْنَ. So it's a must for in worship to have these two conditions. Al-Ikhlas wal-Mutaba'a li Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So to have sincerity for Allah and to follow the Prophet ﷺ. حتى تكون عبادة صحيحة نافعة لصاحبها. So until so that the worship is correct and is a benefit to the person who's doing it. فإن دخلها شرك بطلت. So if shirk enters the worship, then it basically nullifies it. فإذا صارت مبتدئة وإذا صارت مبتدئة ليس عليها دليل فهي باطلة أيضا. So if it becomes an innovation, then there is no proof for, then that's also nullified also. Without these two short conditions, لا فائدة من العبادة. There's no benefit to worship. Yeah, لأنها على غير ما شرع الله. Because it's on other than what Allah has legislated, سبحانه وتعالى. والله لا يقبل إلا ما شرع في كتابه وعلى لسان الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Allah will not accept it except what He has legislated in His book, meaning Quran, or what on the speech of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because even the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم speech, he did not speak from desires. Rather, it was a revelation inspired. So with that, it says, فلا هناك أحد من الخلق يجب اتباعه إلا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما ما عدا رسول فإنه يتبع ويطاع إذا اتبع الرسول أما إذا خالف الرسول فلا طاعة يقول الله تعالى أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولو الأمر منكم وأولو الأمر هم الأمراء والعلماء فإذا طاعوا الله وجبت طاعتهم واتباعهم أما إذا خالفوا أمر الله فإنها لا تجوز طاعتهم ولا اتباعهم فيما خالفوا فيه لأنه ليس هناك أحد يطاع استقلالا من خلق إلا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وما عداه فإنه يطاع ويتبع إذا أطاع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم واتبع رسول الرسول هذه هي العبادة عبادة الصحيحة. So that the Shaykh, he says, so there is no one from the creation that is obligatory to follow him except the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. So no one that we follow unrestrictively except the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. As for other than the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, so then they are what? They are followed and they are obeyed if they follow the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. So they are followed and obeyed if they follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. As for if they differ with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم or oppose the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then there is no obedience to that person. Allah the Most High says, obey Allah and obey the messengers, Rasul and obey the messenger and those who are authority over you. And those who are authority, Ulul Amr, they are the leaders and the scholars. So the Muslim leaders and the scholars. So if they obey Allah, then it's obligatory to obey them and to follow them. But as for if they oppose the commands of Allah, then that is not permissible to obey them or to follow them in that which they oppose Allah in. Yeah, because there is no one that is obeyed independently from the creation except the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So no one is given that obedience independently except the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as long as they fall in line to the Quran and Sunnah, then we obey and we follow that person. So other than the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then he is obeyed and he's followed if he obeys the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yeah, and follows the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is worship. This is the correct form of worship. So with that, inshallah, we stop there. No, we'll carry on because we've got a last bit here. We've got shirk. Talk about shirk here. And then we'll finish on after this page because it's qaidatu ula. So this is the last page. So then Shaykh, he says, فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ الشِّرْكْ إِذَا خَالَتَ الْإِبَادَةَ أَفْسَدَهَا وَأَحْبَتَ الْأَمَلْ وَصَارَ صَاحِبَهُ مِنَ خالدين في النار عرفت أن أهم ما عليك معرفة ذلك So then I'm just gonna, it's a bit difficult to read that, so let me just check. لعل الله أن يخلصك من هذه الشبكة وهي شرك بالله الذي قال الله فيه إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء سورة النساء verse 116. So we can look into that. And then the Shaykh, he mentions وذلك بمعرفة أربع قواعد ذكره الله تعالى في كتابه. So here, this is the last part we're going to read today. So then the Shaykh, he mentions, so if you know, so we know that shirk, we know about tawheed, and that the shirk is the one that nullifies it. And we knew about worship, that there's two conditions: sincerity for Allah and what and following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the Shaykh said, if you know that shirk, if it mixes with worship, then it corrupts it and destroys it. Destroys the actions of the one who does it, and then the person who does it, he becomes from those who will be in the hellfire forever. Then you also know that the most important thing about you is to know that. So if you know the evil, then you can stay away from it. But if you don't know the evil, then you will fall into it. So that is an important principle. You know the evil, not to partake in it, but to stay away from it. So then the Shaykh, he said, I hope that Allah, frees you from this, or he protects you from falling into this web, shabaka. And that is shirk. Yeah, this is shirk with Allah, which Allah said, Inna Allah la yakfiru, that Allah does not forgive that you associate partners with him, and he forgives other than that whoever he wills. And that is the wadalika, and that is by knowing four principles that Allah mentioned in his book. So these four principles that we're going to read about in this book are all taken from the speech of Allah from the Quran. So the Shaykh, he mentions, A, مَا دَامَ أَنَّكَ عَرَفْتَ التَّوْحِيدُ وَهُوَ إِفْرَادُ اللَّهِ بِالْإِبَادَةِ يَجِبُ أَن تَعْرِفْ مَا هُوَ الشِّرْكِ لِأَنَّ الَّذِي لَا يَرِفُ شَيْءٍ يَقَعَ فِيهِ فَلَا بُدَّ أَنَّكَ تَعْرِفُ أَنْوَاعِ الشِّرْكِ مِنْ أَجْلِ أَن تَتَجَنَّبُهَا لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ حَذَّرَ مِنَ الشِّرْكِ وَقَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ فَهَذَا الشِّرْكُ الَّذِي هَذَا خَطَرُهُ وَهُوَ أَنَّهُ يَحْرِمُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ وَيَحْرِمُ مِنَ الْمَغْفِرَةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ. إذن هذا خطر عظيم يجب عليك أن تعرفه قبل أي خطر لأن الشرك ضلت فيه أفهام وأقول لنعرف ما هو الشرك من الكتاب والسنة الله ما حذر من شيء إلا ويبينه وما أمر بشيء إلا ويبينه للناس فهو لن يحرم الشرك ويتركه مجملا بل بينه في القرآن العظيم وبينه الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في السنة بيانا شافيا فإذا أردنا أن نعرف ما هو الشرك نرجع إلى الكتاب والسنة حتى نعرف الشرك ولا نرجع إلى قول فلان وهذا سيأتي. So here the Sheikh he mentions here that so long as you know Tawheed, and that is to single out Allah in worship, then it is obligatory upon you to know what is shirk, the opposite, because the one who does not know something, he can fall into it. So someone who doesn't know a thing, he can fall into it. So therefore, it is upon you to know the different types of shirk so that you can stay away from them. Because Allah warned against shirk when he said, indeed Allah does not forgive that you commit shirk, you make partners with Allah, and he forgives other than that whom he wills. To whoever he wills. So this shirk, which is a great danger, that and it basically is the reason why the Jannah is forbidden for the person who falls into it. Where Allah says, "Innahu man yushrik billahi faqad harrama Allahu alayhi jannah." So indeed, whoever commits shirk with Allah, indeed Allah has made Jannah haram for him. Forbidden for him, and وَيَحْرِمُ مِنَ الْمَغْفِرَةِ, and if Allah made haram for him forgiveness, where Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَكْفِرُ أَن يُشْرِكَ بِهِ, indeed Allah does not forgive the one who commits shirk with him. So therefore, this is a great danger. Shirk is a great danger, and it's obligatory upon you to know it before any other danger, because shirk. So it misguides is fihi afham aqul, the intellects and the understandings of the people. So the people's understanding and intellects have been misguided in regards to the shirk. They have they have gone astray in regarding to shirk. Some people don't understand that. They try to explain it away. So that we know what shirk is, we will look to the Kitab and Sunnah. Allah has not warned against something except that He has clarified it, and He has not commanded with something except that He has clarified it to the people. And Allah has not made something haram, and Allah has not made shirk haram, and then He then just leave it, you know, without explaining it. Rather, He has clarified it in the Quran, in the Great Quran, and He's clarified it. And the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has clarified it in his Sunnah, which was in clearly explained. Yeah. So if we want to know what is shirk, then we need to return back to Kitab and Sunnah, so that we know what shirk is truly. And we do not return to the speech of certain people. And this will come, inshallah. So these four principles now we're getting to understand. These four principles and are what in regards to shirk. So inshallah, with that, we'll stop there and we'll continue next lesson with the first principle. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu alayk. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.